Táto debata vznikla vďaka spolupráci s našim partnerským frontlinom v Londýne, vďaka Flore a Carmichael a vďaka Ondrejovi Starinskému, ktorý sa stará o náš bratislavský frontline a tiež v spolupráci s Asociáciou slovenských obrazových novinárov a s Tomášom Halasom. Takže to bolo úvodné poďakovanie odo mňa. Moje meno je Ľubica Stanek, ja pracujem v nadácii Otvorenej spoločnosti. A dnešné stretnutie sa bude venovať jednému novému zaujímavému konceptu, ktorý je na svete takmer rok, vznikol dávnejšie. O ňom nám povie práve Jan Husár, ktorý je z Emphasis a ktorý má v Emphasis na starosti technické zabezpečenie, architektúru, komunikáciu s fotografmi. Budeme teda hovoriť o projekte Emphasis a budeme hovoriť o tzv. Crowdfunding. A potom neskôr sa dostaneme k Tomášovi, budeme hovoriť s fotografom Thomas van Houtriffenom, ktorý vlastne robil jeden z prvých Emphasis projektov crowdfundingu. Takže k jeho predstaveniu sa dostaneme aj neskôr. Teraz mi dovolte povedať slovo Janovi Husárovi, ktorý nám predstaví celý projekt Emphasis a čo vlastne crowdfunding je.
Dobrý večer. Takže aby sme sa vôbec dostali k tomu, že čo je projekt Emphasis, tak hneď tuto na druhom slajde mám takú otázku, že čo vlastne je ten crowdfunding. Ako, ja ho nazývam mikrofinancovanie, niektorí ľudia nie. Crowdfunding je vlastne financovanie davom. Čiže máte crowd ľudí, ktorých nepoznáte, ideálne na internete, a máte nejaký projekt, ktorý chcete financovať. To spojenie crowdfunding sa používa momentálne vo financovaní od kultúry po film, teraz náš projekt je o tej fotografii, používa sa na rôznych sociálnych veciach. Keď bola kríza na Haiti, tak cez crowdfunding sa tiež dalo dotovať nejaká medzinárodná pomoc. Takže to crowdfunding znamená, že máte nejaký cieľ finančný daného projektu a žiadate ľudí otvorene, aby prispeli. Väčšinou to funguje tak, že začína ten príspevok od $10 a vyššie. A aby tí ľudia dostali niečo naspäť, okrem toho, že prispievajú nejakému projektu, ktorý sa im páči, tak v druhej väčšine ten crowdfunding funguje na tom, že existuje systém odmien. Na základe tej sumy, ktorú dáte, tak máte v tom projekte nejakú tabulku, kde skrátka viete, čo dostanete naspäť. Čiže v prípade nášho projektu to funguje tak, že minimálna suma, aby človek participoval na tom projekte, teda aby ho spolufinancoval, je $10 a tých $10 nám dáva automatický prístup, by som to nazval také do pozadia tvorby toho projektu. Čiže už keď sa naplní financovanie toho projektu, to je jedna z hlavných podmienok vlastne, aby ten projekt začal a naštartoval sa, tak vtedy ten, v našom prípade ten fotograf začne s tými ľuďmi, ktorí financovali od tých $10 a vyššie, privátne komunikovať, sú tam blogy, fóra, skrátka, tí ľudia môžu, Tomáš vám aj ukáže nejaké potom fotky, ktoré vlastne nešli do sveta, ale boli iba pre tých ľudí, ktorí spolufinancovali. A to je v prípade tých $10. Potom tie sumy, ktoré sú vyššie, tak je to väčšinou na tom človeku, ktorý vytvoril ten projekt. Takže napríklad pri $50 mali sme tam ľudí, kde jeho manželka poslala domáce koláčiky tým ľuďom, ktorí dali $50. A pri sumách $100 a vyššie, naozaj, hej. A pri tých sumách $100 a vyššie, tak už sa dá baviť aj o nejakých printoch. Pri nejakých $1000 sumách tí ľudia buď robia nejaké workshopy po svete, alebo môže ísť o limitované printy, môže ísť o printy s autogramom. Viem, že jeden človek mal za nejakých $3000 robil workshop s tým, že nafotil nejaké fotky, ktoré vlastnil iba ten jeden človek na celom svete, ktorý mu dal tých $3000.
Viem, že sa k tomu ešte dostaneme, ale aby sme mali lepší obraz, koľko asi sa fundraizuje na jednu takúto fotografickú akciu, na jeden fotografický šút?
No, z pohľadu nášho, keď sa vám pozrieť na ten average, tak by som povedal, že je to $15,000. Ale čo sa týka crowdfundingu ako takého, tak videl som projekty, ktoré mali tú hranicu na 2000, videl som projekty, ktoré mali tú hranicu na 250,000. Tam išlo v tom prípade, že sa išiel natáčať nejaký dokument full length, čiže bol normálne ako celovečerný film. Takže, a tá výhoda pri tom crowdfundingu je, že keď si človek nastaví tú hranicu napríklad na, neviem, na tých $15,000, tak nám sa stalo, že mali sme taký projekt, ktorý bol nielen o fotografii, ale ten fotograf spolupracoval s jedným takým street artistom a oni začali robiť nad tú sumu, ktorú mali na to vytvorenie toho projektu, začali robiť billboardy proti násiliu v Južnej Amerike a oni týmto spôsobom vlastne zaujali natoľko, že dostali 16 000 od tých ľudí na tvorbu toho projektu a potom dostali ešte ďalších $10 000 úplne naviac, len kvôli tomu, aby mohli tých billboardov čo najviac spraviť. A ten street artel sa volá Ferli Movat, takže to je celkom taký známy človek.
Nechám ťa ísť ďalej v tej prezentácii.
Okay, to len tak, že toto je vlastne crowdfunding, tak to funguje. Ja sa pozerám na to z toho svojho pohľadu. Takže my sme začali v roku 2010 s tým, že v roku 2010 vznikla tá celá myšlienka toho Emphasis, kde sme začali spolupracovať ja s mojim obchodným partnerom po technickej stránke s nejakými fotografmi, ktorí robili na freelance báze pre New York Times a Le Monde a oni sa vlastne stali aj hlavní shareholderi celej tej spoločnosti. Tak sme skrátka vymysleli nejaký taký plán, ktorý začal s tým, že tí ľudia budú väčšinou chodiť pokrývať nejaké konfliktné situácie a takéto, takže musíme spolupracovať s niekým, keby sa náhodou niečo stalo, aby jednak boli poistení a druhák, aby mali aj nejakú reprezentáciu ohľadom práva. Takže preto sme začali robiť z Reporters Without Borders a následne na to World Escapade Travel Insurance, lebo je problém si dať poistiť seba a svoje vybavenie, keď človek ide napríklad fotiť do Afganistánu, hej. Že to hociaká poisťovňa vám nedá. No a samozrejme, ten hlavný partner bol vtedy British Journal of Photography, ktorý sa zaujímal o to, čo robíme, a New York Times, ktorý nám pomohol aj finančne na všetko naštartovať. Takže to bol 2010, kedy sa vlastne uzavreli nejaké dohody, založila sa firma, ale ešte prakticky sa nezačalo robiť. A až v roku 2011, vlastne vo februári, sme začali robiť naozaj technický development, s tým, že v apríli, myslím, že to bolo 9. apríla, sme pustili do sveta tú beta verziu, ktorá bola na tú dobu funkčná, ale veľmi, veľmi veľa chýb tam bolo. Tomas bol jeden z prvých 9 projektov, ktoré tam boli a bol dokonca prvý, ktorý sa nafinancoval. Takže v apríli hneď sa nám stalo to, že ten prvý projekt sa nafinancoval, to bol ten Tomasov projekt, o ktorom bude hovoriť potom. V máji sa nám podarilo dofinancovať 5 projektov z tých 9, ktoré tam boli pôvodne. A boli sme nominovaní ako najinovatívnejšia spoločnosť do roka 2011 s Európskym parlamentom. Čo sme v júni vyhrali ako prvé miesto a potom, my sme sídlíme spoločnosť ako v Írsku, tak Írsky Chamber of Commerce, obchodná komora, OK. Tak obchodná komora nám tiež dala, že máme najinovatívnejší produkt Írska za rok 2011. To boli také tie milestones. A tuto sú vlastne prehľad tých rôznych projektov. Tých prvých 9, teda 8 ich tu mám, jeden som nevedel nájsť. A tu je vidieť, že aký je záujem, že tu je skratka Tomasov projekt, pýtal 8800, dostal 10 000, 140 ľudí mu dalo tie peniaze. Tu je nejaký ďalší projekt, Žilem pýtal 13 600, pravdepodobne ten záujem tam bol nižší, takže tie peniaze, ako fundraiser 985, Keď sa minie ten čas, za ktorý sa fundraizuje ten projekt, tak to funguje tak, že my vlastne vraciame všetky peniaze naspäť tým ľuďom, ale nechávame tam tú hodnotu, aby to bolo vidieť, že aký ten záujem o tú tému bol. Ďalší, Caroline Drake, čo robila, tá dostala tiež o nejakých $3 000 viacej. A tuto tiež tí ľudia. Napríklad tuto je zaujímavé, toto je ten Ferli Movat, čo som hovoril, Pine Ridge Billboard Project, že tam tá suma bola 17 250 a to, čo išlo na to, tak išlo do tých billboardov vlastne na tú produkciu.
A teraz, keď už hovoríme o tom, že čo sa vlastne deje s peniazmi, ktoré sa na fundraizu na tú požadovanú sumu, tak my sme sa chvíľu s Tomasom rozprávali o tom, že čo je vlastne v tej prvej požadovanej sume. A ak teda to môžem stručne zrekapitulovať, sú tam náklady ako bežné, hej, že je tam nejaká letenka, je tam ubytovanie, je tam jedlo, sú tam nejaké takéto základné veci, ale myslím, že v tej prvej sume nie je žiadna odmena pre fotografa, je to tak?
No to záleží, ako si ten fotograf nastaví ten projekt. A vlastne u nás ten business model funguje tak, že my si chargeujeme 10% z tej celkovej sumy, ale pokrývame s tým jednak PayPal, poplatky, Visa, Mastercard a tak ďalej, čo sú není malé teda sumy. A okrem toho poskytujeme vlastne v tom balíku aj to poistenie, ktoré má seba aj svojho vybavenia v rámci toho daného projektu. A tuto sú ešte posledné dva. Takže viac menej väčšina z tých projektov, ktorých bolo prvých 9, tak ten záujem tam bol. Tých ľudí vlastne spolufinancovať tieto veci.
Ako sa dá prihlásiť do takéhoto projektu, alebo aby nejaký fotograf, neviem, môže niekto z našich slovenských fotografov tam poslať svoje práce a automaticky sa tam dostane, alebo je tam nejaký spôsob výberu?
No, no tie prvé projekty boli vybrané, teda takto, existuje nejaká komisia, ktorá nie je priamo súčasťou tej firmy alebo Emphasis, tých ľudí je zhruba 30, oni sú aj na tej stránke. A sú to väčšinou nejakí direktorov fotografií, National Geographic, rôznych médií, hlavne týždenníky, denníky a mesačníky sú to. Takže, a ľudia, ktorí majú na starosti fotografiu, je tak z managementu, alebo robia s fotografmi. Takže to je kvázi nezávislé. Samozrejme, v tej prvej vlne tých 9 projektov to boli projekty, ktoré sme sa snažili, aby boli nejaké zaujímavé, aby tam boli mená, ktoré naozaj sú celosvetovo známe, aby sa to naozaj podarilo. Teraz už sme v takej fáze, že sme ochotní prijať a vlastne akýkoľvek projekt. Momentálne teraz sa pracuje aj na tom, že bude sa dať submitovať online, teda že online sa budú formuláre na to prispôsobené, aby skrátka človek, ktorý chce dostať projekt na Emphasis, tak bude si to moc pekne vyklikať a potom samozrejme to príde na tú komisiu, ale bude to o to jednoduchšie, že nemusí niekde mailovať, dotazovať sa, ako sa to rieši. Takže takýto je spôsob. Takže to bol vlastne začiatok, potom samozrejme po tých prvých prvotných partneroch, tak sa tam začali ozývať nejaké ďalšie spoločnosti, ktoré mali záujem s nami robiť. Konkrétne medzi prvé patril BBC a LeMond, lebo jednak tá fotografia, ktorá tam bola, tak oni chceli spolupracovať buď s tými fotografmi, alebo mali záujem spolupracovať priamo s nami a podporovať nejaké projekty. Wired Magazine bol dokonca tak zaujímavý, teda my sme boli pre nich tak zaujímaví, že jednak nám dávajú marketingový priestor a druhák bez toho, aby mali nárok na nejaké veľké odmeny, spolufinancujú nejaké projekty. Konkrétne poviem potom neskôr, budem tam mať obrázky, že ktorí spolufinancovali. National Geographic, ten sa k nám pridal asi 3 mesiace dozadu, keď sme začali robiť náš druhý ochranársky projekt. No a tuto je vlastne nejaký ten background, že na začiatku to vyzeralo, čo som videl tie projekty a tie projekty, ktoré sa hlásili k nám, tak boli to väčšinou nejaké konflikty alebo veci ohľadom chudoby, tretí svet a vyzeralo to, že to pôjde iba tým smerom. Všetky projekty, ktoré sa hlásili, aj tie, ktoré nie sú na tej stránke, lebo ja som videl tie projekty, ktoré ľudia submitli, že chcú ísť na tú stránku, tak vždy to bolo ohľadom tohoto. A posledné 3 mesiace skrátka sa nám stalo, že prihlásil sa nám 5 projektov, ktoré sa týkajú prírody alebo ochrany prírody. A to je taká špeciálna téma, ktorá sa volá Conservation for Photography. S tým k nám prišiel aj National Geographic potom. Teda oni boli oslovení tým, že my sme začali robiť conservation photography a jedna z tých prvých vecí bolo, jeden fotograf monitoruje už dlho, fotí ľadovce, ktoré miznú postupne po svete. A toto bol zrovna jeden projekt, ktorý oslovil Wired a dal mu $5,000 a pritom Wired je technologický magazín. A keď sme sa pýtali, že prečo vlastne Wired podporil takýto štýl projektu, tak oni povedali, že ten budget tam bol a im sa to páčilo. A potom za tých 5000 mali to, že chalan išiel do Londýna im spraviť privátny workshop. To mali tú odmenu nasetapovanú v tých odmenách. A ďalší taký conservation projekt je návrat tej čiernej korytnačky, čo je celkom zaujímavé. Tuto mám tie glaciers odfotené nejaké. A tu je tá korytnačka. S tou korytnačkou je to, že v tom Mexiku tie korytnačky tam skoro vyvraždili a na základe toho, že ten fotograf tam pôsobil a dokumentoval to s nejakými ďalšími biológmi, tak sa podarilo vlastne nejakým spôsobom dosiahnuť, že tie korytnačky sú tam teraz chránené a je ich tam viacej a má to naozaj že reálny dopad. A tento projekt bol financovaný, aj prefinancovaný vlastne cez Emphasis. No a to bol také akože tie príjemné story. Jedna z takých tých zlých story je, že robili sme s Timom Hetteringom a Chrisom Hondrosom, ktorí, teda pripravovali sme s nimi projekt, oni mali ísť do Líbie, keď tam boli teraz tie problémy a bolo to tak nasetapované, že vrátia sa z Líbie a začnú robiť ten projekt s nami a vlastne stalo sa to, že oni tam boli tam zabití, hej. Takže to je trocha taký ten údel toho takéhoto fotožurnalizmu, že tak sme jednak napísali o tom blog post, ale je to, takže je to také, že takéto veci sa môžu stať, keď človek robí tie projekty. No a teraz nejaké fakty, lebo veľa ľudí si myslí, že zmyslom tej stránky je, aby sme mali strašne veľa, 100 tisíce návštevníkov a tak ďalej. Ja, keď som pripravil ten projekt, tak som tiež mal taký istý názor, že treba mať strašne veľa návštevníkov a potenciálne niečo z tých návštevníkov vypadne. Ale počas fungovania toho projektu sme zistili, že tých návštevníkov je celkom málo, ale väčšina z nich sa zaujíma o to, aby financovali tie projekty. Takže prvých 1000 návštevníkov, čo sme mali, tak zafinancovalo vlastne ten projekt, ktorý robil Tomas. A za 15 dní, odkedy sme spustili tú prvú verziu, tak $2000 bola vlastne najvyššia suma, ktorú dal jeden človek. Za 20 dní to bolo $3000, ktorú dal jeden človek, že mal záujem jednak o tú odmenu, ktorú mu ponúkal ten projekt, ale bol ochotný dať ako osoba cez nejakú neznámu web stránku na fotografický projekt $3000. Keď sme mali prvých 10 tisíc návštevníkov, tak vlastne 5 projektov už bolo prefinancovaných v tom momente. A za 45 dní, čo sme boli online, tak $1000 bola skupina, čo som zabudol dodať, to bola hudobná skupina, ktorá sama prispela na nejaký projekt. 60 dní spoločnosť dala 3000, teraz už je to 5000, lebo to bol ten Wired, tento topol. A za 80 dní by publisher $5000, to bol National Geographic, ktorý aj potom začal robiť s tými korytnačkami a viem, že pripravujú nejaké číslo o tom do National Geographic. Takže taký ten priemerný príspevok je celkom zaujímavé, že to takto vychádza, ale tá suma priemerne, prvá je $50, ktorú každý človek tam zhruba nechá, čo tam necháva peniaze, a druhá suma, ktorú tam ľudia nechávajú, je $500, čo je celkom zaujímavé. Takže to sú také dve kategórie. Jedný, ktorým sa to páči a chcú menej prispieť, a potom taký, čo sa im to páči a chcú viacej prispieť. A keď sa na to pozrieme z matematického hľadiska, tak keď videlím tých počet návštevníkov, na to, koľko peňazí tam bolo prefinancovaných, tak to vychádza, že $2 za každého návštevníka, za každého unikátneho návštevníka. A neplatíme si žiadnu reklamu nikde. Ani sme si. Ale boli sme samozrejme vo všetkých tých médiách, boli sme na frontpage New York Times dvakrát tento rok, takže tie médiá...
No, a boli ste, myslíš, fotografie, ktoré vznikli v rámci tohto projektu, alebo...
Ale bolo tam spomenuté Emphasis, ale bolo to skôr o tej fotografii, hej.
Že vy ste si to kúpili, alebo médiá si kúpili vaše fotky, ktoré boli?
No, nie. Oni to spravili na základe toho, dostali akurát publisher rights od toho fotografa, a oni spravili články o tom ich projekte a o nás.
Ďakujem Janovi Husárovi za predstavenie tohto projektu. A možno predtým, ako bude priestor na otázky, by som teraz obrátila možno trošku pohľad a perspektívu na fungovanie Emphasis. A dala by som slovo Tomášovi van Houtvenovi, ktorý vlastne je jeden z prvých fotografov, ktorý, ako Jan spomínal, nafundraizoval potrebnú sumu a vytestoval a robil prvý takýto photo assignment. Ja by som ho ešte krátko predstavila, máme trošku čas, takže zamerieva sa na dokumentovanie naliehavých problémov na celom svete a je považovaný za jedného z popredných svetových fotografov svojej generácie. Zaujímavé možno z backgroundu jeho je, že pôvodne študoval filozofiu a o fotografiu sa začal zaujímať na zahraničnom študijnom pobyte v Nepále. Po absolvovaní školy bol vyslaný agentúrou Associated Press do Latinskej Ameriky a bol prvým fotografom Associated Press, ktorý fotil vojenskú väznicu v Guantanamo Bay na Kube. A v roku 2002 odišiel do Kandaharu, kde nafotil rodiny väzňov z Guantanama. Z agentúry Associated Press odišiel v roku 2003, aby sa mohol sústrediť na väčšie projekty a možno k tomu sa práve teraz dostávame. A ešte mi dovolte spomenúť, nedá mi nepochváliť sa prestížnymi oceneniami nášho hostia. V roku 2006 sa Tomáš stal jedným z 30 nádejných talentov roka podľa Photo District News. V roku 2008 získal Alicia Peterson Journalism Fellowship. Myslím, že ten bol jedným, z ktorých kofinancoval práve jeho 7-ročnú prácu Behind the Curtains, ktorá mapuje život v 7 zostávajúcich komunistických krajinách, kam patrí Severná Korea, Kuba, Čína, Nepál, Laos, Vietnam a Moldavsko. A teda ešte na záver uvediem, že Tomáš je členom fotografickej agentúry Seven Photo Agency. Viem, že svoju show začneš práve fotografiami z rôznych krajín práve z tejto výstavy Behind the Curtain. Myslím, že je práve v Cardiffe na výstave. A možno na úvod, ak by nám mohol povedať, že čo ťa vlastne inšpirovalo, alebo prečo si sa rozhodol venovať sa krajinám, kde stále existuje nejaká forma komunistického režimu alebo komunistickej spoločnosti.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. Thanks for having me. So you were asking, how did I get onto this subject of communism? When I was a student, I studied in Nepal, in the Himalayan country of Nepal. And later I went on to become a staff photographer from the Associated Press, but I kept watching Nepal from afar. And a communist revolution started there. And it was the only communist revolution to start after the fall of the Berlin Wall and the collapse of the Soviet Union. So I quit my job for the Associated Press and I started covering this story as a freelancer on my own in Nepal. and I started the coverage in 2004 all the way until the Maoist revolutionaries managed to overthrow the King of Nepal in 2008 and declare a republic. So I'll go through some of those photos and then the other communist countries that I started to visit afterwards. So this is in the Maoist rebel-controlled areas. And this is a statue of the king being protected by his security forces. And this is the king himself. He was a Hindu and he was considered to be a living god. And in Nepal, they had the Hindu caste system, and so the Maoists would go from village to village and preach Marxist equality and to end the caste system. And they would recruit a lot of untouchables and low-caste people until they eventually had an army, a rebel army. And they would also drive people out of their areas that they considered class enemies, like this woman was a higher caste woman, and I photographed her in a camp for refugees. And these are other refugees that fled, and so the capital of Nepal is Kathmandu, so slums started forming of displaced people around Kathmandu. And eventually the Royal Army started fighting against the Maoists, and there was mostly a ceremonial army when the war started, but they got guns from the United Kingdom and the United States and India and trained into a professional army and doubled their size, and so it became a really intense civil war. This is the cremation of a Nepal police officer who was killed by Maoists. And then the conflict came from the rural areas where the Maoists were fighting and started coming in the cities. And there became more and more protests in Kathmandu. And at the same time, the king started reacting to the Maoist threat by seizing power and turning it into an absolute monarchy. And he banned protests in the capital. And eventually this situation reached its climax in the spring of 2006, where he banned, the king set a curfew and banned any protest, and people continued to protest until they were shot. They are throwing a picture of the king out. And eventually the king backed down, and the Maoists came out of the jungle and they made a peace agreement with the other political parties in Nepal, and they decided to hold elections. And the Maoist party won the majority of votes and they changed the constitution and declared it a republic and abolished the monarchy. So this is the day that Nepal was turned into a republic. Just a couple of photos from behind the scenes. This is myself on a horse here. And I was, in the beginning, I was working alone in Nepal, but along the way, I started making partnerships with various journalists, and I eventually got an assignment for Time Magazine. So this is a Time Magazine writer that was with me. And this is how our story was eventually published.
So this story was not done through the embassy, though?
No.
This was done
this started
prior
in
to that.
2004, and it was started as a personal project that I financed myself, and eventually magazines got involved along the way, and that's how I could keep the project going. And from Nepal, you know, I got curious about communism because it was reviving in Nepal, and so I started taking a look around and thought, you know, what are the other countries that are still communist around the world? And it turns out that there are 7 countries in the world where the Communist Party is the ruling party still. So the next one we're going to is North Korea here.
How many times are you able to come to these countries?
Nepal I went to many times. I may have been there, you know, 8 or 10 times. Cuba also I went many times. I was only allowed into North Korea twice, so between 2 and 10 times per country. And sometimes I was able to get assignments from newspapers and magazines to go there, and sometimes I would go on my own, and then I got a grant that you mentioned, the fellowship, and that paid for some of the travel. So all in all, this is a 7-year project, which I just finished this year. And the last part of the project I did on emphasis.
You would not want to go there again, or were you not allowed to come, or you think you would
to
not
North Korea? Yeah. I just haven't tried because I've published with my name critical arguments, so there's a good chance that I would not be welcome there again. And North Korea is in the news now because Kim Jong-il, the dictator, just died. But it was by far the most difficult country to cover. It was almost impossible to get a visa. Once I arrived there, everything happens in a group. You have a government guide with you at all times that tells you where you can and can't go. They take away your mobile phone and your passport the day you arrive, and they don't give it back to you until the day you leave. But I managed to go with some special delegations that have more access, so I was able to see more than normal tourists or the few journalists that get in the country could see. So for example, with one of the delegations, we were allowed into the military academy, and these are the only photos I'm aware of taken by a Western photographer in the military academy. Everywhere you go, you have pictures of Kim Il-sung and Kim Jong-il. This is on top of the airport when you arrive. And I went back a second time with a business delegation posing as a business investor, and that way I was able to get in and photograph factories. Also inside of hospitals and schools. This is my hotel room, and they only had 3 TV channels, and they were all playing either pictures of Kim Jong-il or military movies or the flag waving and patriotic songs. There was nothing else to watch. And then just a few photos from behind the scenes. These are the books that you can buy in the bookstores there. One on the right is a young man's memoirs of his escape from South Korea, not North Korea. So the propagandists were quite creative. These are the stamps that you can buy in the store there. these are the kind of posters, pictures, you know, saying screw the USA and missiles hitting the US Capitol building. And this is the only kind of image that most North Koreans would see of the outside world. They have no access to external media. They have no access to the internet. So what they know about the West and the United States is from this kind of propaganda images. We even went into a museum called the Museum of U.S. Atrocities, where they had many paintings like this, and this is a painting, supposedly, of an American priest and an American doctor torturing a North Korean baby. And while we were there, they were taking one school child after another in to see these paintings. So how did I get in there? Since they don't give good access to journalists, decided to make a fake company, and so I was a chocolate consultant going to look into opening a chocolate factory in North Korea, and working with a French journalist. The two of us were a team. We made a chocolate website, and they brought us to this place where they said that we could put in our chocolate machines if we wanted to. There's my minder taking pictures of me. And then we had these lavish business dinners with North Korean officials. And on one day we even did a chocolate tasting, so I managed to blindfold my minder for a few minutes and get him to taste chocolates.
Did you get any letter from them? No. They must have been pretty mad. Yeah.
I have more to worry about now. So on to Cuba, which after North Korea is the second most severe communist country that's left. It's the only other one that has a completely state-controlled economy.
How did you get to Cuba? Was it an assignment from a newspaper, or was it again your own private?
I initially went on my own the first time, and then when Fidel Castro fell sick in 2006, then I called some magazines, and I eventually got an assignment from Newsweek and another one from the New York Times, and so I went back several times, sometimes on my own, sometimes with assignments. And Cuba's a very beautiful and seductive country, wonderful culture, wonderful weather. It's like a paradise island, but after you've been to North Korea, you start seeing echoes of some of the same thing there, the pictures everywhere of the leaders, the kids wearing pioneer outfits, the Soviet weaponry, parades, the obsession for everything related to the military. And they're in a very hard economic situation because they have the state-planned economy and there's a blockade by the United States. So people are always trying to get by. This is in a state bakery. People have ration cards where they fill out and they get a certain amount of food every month, but it's not enough for a person to survive. It's about a third. And for the rest, they kind of get from the black market or trade with each other. This is a ferry boat that crosses the Bay of Havana, and it's a very, very slow ferry boat, but there's almost no boats left in Cuba because most of them have been taken to flee to the United States, to Florida. And so on this particular one, to get on the ferry boat, you have to go through a metal detector because a year before I was there and took this picture, a few guys tried to get on it and hijacked it and tried to take it to the United States, and then they were caught and charged as terrorists and executed. Picture of Fidel on his 80th birthday. And Fidel said that all art should have to be in line with the revolution. And so you see strange things like this. This is a girl who's covered with Che Guevara and Camilo Cienfuegos, two of the Cuban revolutionaries. So on to Moldova. So Moldova is the only European country that has the Communist Party, and it was a Soviet republic, and then it in 2000 it voted democratically, the Communist Party back in power. And so from 2000 until 2009 they ruled the country. And then in 2009 there was some elections that were disputed, and riots broke out, and since then you have a three-party coalition, but they don't have enough of a majority to name a president. And they also have a breakaway area of the country called Transnistria, which is kind of run by former KGB and Soviet officials, Soviet army officials, where they kept all the symbols from the Soviet days up. They kept all the uniforms of the KGB. They didn't reform their institutions. This is an orphanage that hasn't changed since Soviet times. Inside the National Theater. This is on a celebration day. They just renamed the KGB the MGB there, but they kept the hammer and sickle and Lenin's statue. And their government office in Transnistria is still called the Soviet Supreme. This is right after the elections, where people were protesting against the results. And they managed to ransack the parliament and get inside the presidential palace. All this is happening in 2009. Okay, on to Vietnam. So this is one of the countries that's kept the Communist Party in power, but they have a free market system now. They've completely liberalized their economy. And it happened rather quickly. The Communists won the war in 1975, and already in the mid-80s, they started putting in economic reform. So it had a very, very short period of Communist economy. These are graves of people who were killed on the Vietnamese side during the war with the United States. Ho Chi Minh. This was kind of a funny story. This is International Women's Day, which was a festival that was started in the Soviet Union. And this is at the headquarters of the Communist Party Youth League. And this is what they decided to do on that day, is have a big promotion for Cosmopolitan magazine. So that just shows how much things have changed. And China is such a big country, I wasn't sure what story to do on it. But I found a little village in China that decided to completely recollectivize. So Chinese have a free market economy, but this one village, the party secretary there is a huge fan of Mao, and he convinced all of the villagers to hand over the titles to their property and make it a collectively run village. So everybody has an identical apartment. They put a huge Mao statue up in the middle of the village, and he opened 12 factories, and one of the factories makes Mao statues. And the people have no salaries. They're paid in coupons, which they can use to buy food only in the village. There's no private businesses. It's a small village. There's only 3,500 people. This is the hotel when you walk in there, and it's become a tourism destination. They call it red tourism in China, where people go and visit revolutionary sites and communist sites for nostalgic reasons or to see how it was. And I also went to visit some other red tourism sites. This is Yan'an in China, which is where Mao Zedong ended the long march and was declared the chairman of the Communist Party. And they've built a huge hall to him there. And it attracts tens of thousands of Chinese tourists there every year. And they even do battle reenactments. So this is made for tourists. People dress up as soldiers, and the Chinese Maoists fight against the Kunmingtao in battles, reproducing the Revolutionary War. And you can pay a little bit extra and put on a Chinese uniform and run with them on the battlefield. There's fake bombs going off and things like that. And the funny thing is that the actual day I took this picture, this was in November 2009, it was the exact day of the 20th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall. So here in Europe, people were having a ceremony celebrating the end of communism. Over there in China, they were having a reenactment of the beginning of communism in China. So in order to finish this project, I needed to go back to Laos. I'd gone one time, just for a few days, with the New York Times. I tried to get an assignment from other magazines, from the New York Times, to go back. And Laos is a very small, obscure country, and none of the media was interested. And just about the time that I was getting near the end of my project, Emphasis was launched, and so I decided to try to go back to Laos, funded with Emphasis. So I made a short video of 3 minutes explaining what the clip was, explaining what the project was. And then you see here on the right side, you have the rewards. So there's different things that people who support the project get in return for the money that they put into it, just as Jan was explaining. So in my case, I had for $10, people get access to a private blog. They can see what's happening behind the scenes as I'm doing the project. For $25, I sent them a photographic postcard. And then for $75, I sent them a book of the project. And then for $125, it was a hardcover, limited edition, the signed book. You could have your name put in the book. And then for $500, it was a prototype of the big book of all of the communist countries, and up to prints, or all the way at the top, $3,000, an organization could sponsor it and get their logo in the book. So how did I attract people to it? You see, I had 142 people that eventually backed the project. Mostly it was sharing through social media, so I posted it on Facebook, like you see here. I posted it on Twitter. I reached out, contacted a lot of different blogs. One of the things I did is, these days on the internet, a lot of bloggers just try to steal your photos and post them online without asking. And so I tried to turn it to my advantage. I went and searched for those people, and I wrote to them, hey, you're using my picture. Can you post my Emphasis proposal, a link to it? And people started doing that. And so eventually there was kind of a buzz created on the internet, people sharing it with their friends, and slowly different backers found it and were attracted in. And on the other side, Emphasis sends out a newsletter, and they try to contact people to bring people in. But this really was like full-time work for a few weeks, being very active on blogging, social media, mailing to a large list of contacts to get people involved, especially since this was the first project that was put up. A lot of people were still didn't know about it.
So did you leave for Laos after you actually reached the sum?
So my original plan was to leave for Laos only after I had finished with the campaign and it was fully funded. But since there were some technical delays launching the website and there was a really important anniversary in Laos, the 90th anniversary of the Communist Party that I wanted to photograph, I ended up starting the campaign, and then I decided to leave halfway through it, basically. And so I was just spending on my credit card, hoping that the project would be paid off. And so in the end it was. And so people who backed the project right away, they could have access to the blog and see what I was doing right away.
You have time to blog with them? How often do you blog with people
about every 3 or 4 days, kind of depending on where I could find internet access in Laos, which is a very rural country, I would take notes along the way, and if I saw something interesting or took pictures of something that might not be perfect for the book but might be interesting for people following the project, I would post it on the blog. And people started commenting on it quite a bit, and so I really tried to encourage that and answer their comments as fast as possible. Because one of the things I thought is, you know, people can get their news from different sources. Why would they, you know, back a photographer directly instead of buying a newspaper or a magazine, something like that? And I thought this interactivity where the journalist is on the ground and right away they can ask them a question and get a response, that's something that you normally can't do with a television or newspaper or magazine. So I really tried
So how many people actually backed you on this? How many people contributed?
It was 142. And
how many communicated with you? Then how many decided to be active?
There was about 30 people that were actively leaving comments as I was blogging from Laos. And then some of them I would tell them, you know, things about what I was reporting along the way. Other times I would give them kind of insights into my working style. So one day I did a blog post about which cameras I bring with me, how I'm, you know, just the technical aspects of working as a photojournalist in the field. And because I was, some of the people that I'd contacted were professors of journalism and things like that, and they shared it with their class. And, you know, a student can't pay, you know, $500 for something, but $10 to watch a photographer in the field when you're learning about photographer and see how day-to-day they do it and what equipment they use and how they find a translator and things like that. It's like you're getting a workshop from a photographer and you can ask questions for $10 instead of, you know, something that would be very expensive. So you can get all kinds of backers at different levels, from people who are collecting prints at a very high level to people who are learning about photography for $10. So sometimes there was funny things that came up. This is some of the photos I put on the, just for the blog, for the backers. One day I was photographing inside an old apartment complex in Laos, which had been built by Soviet engineers, and I came across this old briefcase, and the woman on the top floor said she didn't know what it was and that I could have it. It had been sitting up there for 15 years or something, and I can't read Russian, and for me it looked like something from a James Bond movie. So I photographed it and I put it up on the blog for the backers, and some guys on there, they could read Russian, and they started doing research and they were able to find out what it was. It's an old Russian prototype computer, like the earliest MacBook you can imagine, I guess.
So actually your backers were even helpful in actually maybe giving you some information, some advice?
Yeah, well, it was interesting to see who they were. Some of them were interested in photography, but some were specifically interested in Laos, the country. And there was one really early backer who'd lived in Laos for a few years that was kind of a off and on photographer. And he actually gave me a list of places to photograph and some of those places I went to. And he was really helpful. He had contacts for me. There was another woman who works for a company making cosmetic products, and one of the ingredients from their products comes from villages in Laos. And she'd looked on the internet everywhere to try to find out what is life like in these villages for Laos. She couldn't find anything. She found, you know, tourist things about Laos and the Lonely Planet and things, but not much about real life. And so she backed the project so she could find out what life was like in Laotian villages. And there were some people for Eastern Europe, some Polish guys who had grown up under communist regime, and they were interested to see what it was like today. So some people came for photographic reasons, some people came in interest for Laos, and some came because of political reasons.
So after they backed you, were they able to make some requirements? Were they able maybe to say, okay, I would really like to see how women and children live in this area, and then you would sort of sue to that?
There was one guy that thought some of the pictures I took were quite extreme, showing poverty, and then there was some pictures I took of daily life of people, and he said he was really able to connect with that much easier, and so he asked for more pictures of daily life. So I did that for him, and I thought it was good to add to the project, but at the same time, you know, I had to stay on focus and stay on my goal. I had to produce the same kind of photos I had in the other communist countries so I would have a unified body of work. So I stayed focused, but I was able to accommodate some of the backers' requests too. And then what this shows is when I was done, I I put the photos online, my 100 photos, and then I let the backers rate them and put comments and decide what their favorite pictures were and which ones, to help me select which ones would end up in the book. So you can see people added stars, and then they would add comments underneath the photos.
So these were, again, the backers. Those were able to make the comments.
Yeah, the only people who were able to do this were the backers who had supported the project, basically. So from crowdfunding, I decided to do kind of an experiment in crowd editing to see how it would go.
It seems to me like a dream job. Like, you don't have a photo editor from a news desk who is telling you what to do. It's pretty much on you. Are there any downsides?
Well, you have to, if you're ever going to put yourself out and open and public on the internet, you have to be very sure of your ideas and ready to defend it, because there's people who come and do negative comments and attack and might say things like, I've already seen this kind of work before, why should I fund a new project, things like that. So you have to be ready for that. You're putting yourself out publicly. Whatever, if you go and talk to a news editor privately and he says your portfolio is crap, it's only between you and him and that's it. But what happens on the internet is public, so you have to have a come up with a really good idea, you have to come up with something original, and you have to come up with something that connects with people and be able to defend your idea. And the other thing is, it's a lot of work. Instead of just convincing one single person, maybe at a magazine in New York or in London, you have to convince 100 people in order to do your project. But you're not convincing them for thousands, convincing them to do $10 or $50. And so it is, it's hard work. That's, I would say the only downside to this is it's a lot of work to do. But I met interesting people. I had new contacts from Laos that I wouldn't have had otherwise. And I had direct relationships with my audience, whereas normally if I publish in a newspaper or magazine, I have no idea what the people think about the photos, why they bought the newspaper or magazine. So this was interesting to have, actually, to see who really cares, you know, when you do a photo.
But what happens with the photos afterwards?
The photos, the copyright stays with the photographer, so he can do whatever he wants with it afterwards. He can go and sell it to newspapers and magazines. He can give it to a agency to try to sell for him, or he can make his own distribution method, like making a web documentary for the internet, making a book to give out to people, put it on his own website. So it's up to you. It's your own choice. In my case, in how Emphasis is designed, is that the funding should pay for the production of the work, but not for the salary of the photographer, unless it's overfunded. But the budget that you submit should only be for the production costs. But a clever photographer will try to earn their living afterwards, either by selling those photos to a newspaper or magazine, or coming up with a product at the end of the day that they can sell that helps make them earn their living, like a book or prints or something like that. So here's some more comments from other photographs. Okay, and so at the end, I did make this book. And then from the photos that got the highest number of stars, I tried editing different things and I tried different page layouts. So this is one of the final page layouts, and once I had those, I put that on the internet for the backers to comment on also. And most of the page layouts stayed, but I made a few changes based on their criticisms.
So the backers were interested even to comment the layout?
Yeah, they told me what they thought worked or didn't work or what didn't understand. You know, some things, when I was on the ground photographing, I knew exactly what happened, and I think people can understand it when they see the photo. But if you don't have the context and you just see the photo, maybe you don't have the full story. So people would ask, what's going on here? Maybe you should get rid of that one. It doesn't work for me, or this is great. So in the end, this work will actually have many different lives. It's going to be a chapter in my big book about all the communist countries, which is coming out in March. It's part of this little book that I've made that was for backers and also distributed to an NGO that contributed to the project. My agency has an online area where they do five-minute web documentaries, like video and photo presentations, so it went on the Seven website. And and some magazines and newspapers will publish individual photographs of it also, and Swiss Magazine is also going to publish it as a story. So the photos that were made possible by the Emphasis backers would then have many lives in different areas.
So basically what happened that originally you suggested that you were not able to find interest in the big papers, big magazines to fund your visit to Laos, and after you've made the story, after you made some buzz on the internet, after you find people who contributed, who backed you, then the papers got interested and your stories were printed.
Well, often in order to fund a project like this, the only people who can do it is like a really big magazine in the United States or France or Germany or something like that. However, once the photographs have already been produced, a smaller magazine like in Switzerland or Slovakia or Belgium or something like that, who can only pay 100 or a couple hundred euros for a whole reportage, they have access to it. But that kind of money would never send me to Laos. So because of Emphasis, I could get sent to Laos, and then later you can sell it to smaller media, basically. And actually, it attracts quite a lot of attention when you do the campaign, because on the mailing list of Emphasis are photo editors from all over the world. They send, you know, the email with all their new projects to hundreds and hundreds of photo editors. And so once in a while, a magazine sees something, and then later they contact the photographer and buy it, or during the campaign, they put in $1,000 or $5,000 to help the project happen. And then what was also useful is, since I've been blogging every few days, I eventually compiled that into a single text, and I made that the essay that goes in the book with it. So it wasn't wasted work, it had a second use also. But it took quite a bit of discipline to update the social media and take notes. You have to act, you have to have a strong idea, you have to be sure in it, you have to act more like a journalist rather than just a photographer taking pictures. You have to take on some other responsibilities and some initiative.
But you entered this project, Emphasis project, already as a member of a very strong photo agency, as a person who published previously in the biggest papers and magazines. So what does it tell us about the current photojournalism? Is it in decline? Is it that there are simply no more money, or is there no interest? What is happening? Why do you have to actually go to crowdfunding?
Yeah, the media specifically has gone through some very severe crises in the last few years, in addition to a very long, slow decline. And then you have the financial crisis in the United States, and now the one that's coming to the Eurozone. So for each of these, photojournalism has suffered. It's also suffering from the fact that people are getting their news from online instead of from magazines and newspapers. People communicate in a new way now. So Emphasis kind of harnesses the new way of communicating a little bit better. And that helps make up for the declining budgets in newspapers and magazines. Newspapers and magazines are so worried about their survival that many of them don't want to do hard and difficult social stories, hard and difficult journalism. They want to do things that sell easily. Celebrity news is up, travel journalism is up, and things like that. So for a photojournalist like myself, it seems like these are the opportunities that the press is focusing on now, and less of this traditional style concerned photojournalism. And so you have to turn to grants or Emphasis or your own personal funds to do this kind of work.
Is this all that you do now? I mean, this proper old style photojournalism?
How do you mean?
Do you have other, let's say, commercial work that you do, or is this sufficient too?
I do some travel assignments for the New York Times and some other assignments, but I don't do any commercial or corporate work on the side. Once in a while, I do work with NGOs, but really, 80% of the work I do is reportage and photojournalism, basically, and it's been like that since before Emphasis existed, because I would try to find a grant or some other way to keep my project going over the years.
So do you plan to apply with another project to the Emphasis? Do you want to have
yeah,
something?
Yeah, I have another project in mind. It depends a little bit on the timing, so it's to continue working on North Korea. I've been inside North Korea, as I've shown, and then earlier this year I started working along the borders of North Korea. So I photographed the China-North Korea border, and now I'd like to photograph the South Korea-North Korea border. But Kim Jong-il just died a few days ago, so it's not something that I should put off for 3 months. I should try to get there as fast as possible. So first I'm trying to contact these magazines, because it's in the news, to see if anybody will send me. If that doesn't work, then I'll probably put up an emphasis project.
And so how does it look? Is anyone interested, or you have to get the
what's that?
Backing? How does it look? Is anyone interested, or you have to go
The problem emphasis? I'm running to right now is that many of the magazine that I work with right now are closed for Christmas, or have already decided what issue is coming out next week. They decided it months ago, so everybody could go on vacation right now. They do the end of the year and things like that. So I'm having a hard time finding a magazine interested in sending me for this story, so may have to go with emphasis in the end.
What I find great about this is that maybe at the end of the day, I mean, after a year or two, it's actually going to get back or hit back the photo editors, that if they see that people are actually interested, they're willing to put their own money to back a project like that, and perhaps the traditional Korea's the traditional journals and magazines will go back into this traditional old style in-depth photojournalism, and perhaps more outlets with such things will again reappear.
Yeah, I think it shows a proof that there is an audience, and an audience that's willing to invest fairly heavily. For somebody to put $50 in is a pretty big commitment. It's a pretty big stake that they put in a project. So if they're doing that, that's proof that there's audiences out there that really care about these things. Otherwise, none of them would get funded. So if we can use that as an argument to say to the media, hey, wake up, you know, focus on these things too. Don't just focus on celebrity news and what seems pleasing or easy to advertisers, but focus on the real work of journalism, the kind of things that we learn about our world. This is one way to put pressure back on them.
Now the people you're talking about are the people who are actually selecting the projects that will go on emphasis, right? You're not talking about
No, I'm talking about the actual backers on the internet. Yeah.
Okay, but how about the beginning of the process? Like, you send the idea, and who is there to decide which project is going to go to emphasis and which will not?
From what I understand is there's this board with emphasis that's mostly made out of professionals in the media industry. So these can be photo editors, other photographers, museum curators, people who know photography and know what it takes for a project to succeed. So you make a budget for them, you make a synopsis, and you show them a portfolio. And based on that, if it looks realistic and like you can do it, boom, they approve it and they put it online, and then it's up for internet users to decide whether it succeeds or fails. If it looks like your budget has some questionable things in it or not so good, then they'll send those criticisms back to you and you can modify it and send it in again, basically. So it's my understanding is the purpose of this board is to make sure that only, you know, good quality projects make it up on the internet, and so you don't go on the Emphasis website and find a bunch of shoddy things that are on there.
Precisely.
Nech sa páči, priestor pre ďalšie otázky, ak sú.
Prekladateľia mikrofón. Asi, neviem.
Áno, potrebujeme to kvôli prekladaniu.
Ďakujem, že aké sú ďalšie plány Emphasisu?
Takže ďalšie plány Emphasisu sú, jednak my sme strašne malý projekt, teda malý mladý a malý projekt, lebo keď sa pozrieme na všetky tie crowdfundingové portály, tak väčšinou majú za sebou investorov v desiatkoch miliónov a my sme na bázi ani nie v stovkách tisíc dolárov. Začiatok aj pokrytie vlastne všetkého. Takže u nás veci troška trvajú dlhšie, nemáme niekde tým 20 developerov, ktorí by skrátka non-stop operovali na tom sajte. A najbližšie plány sú jedna, ktorá bola aj pôvodná podmienka, čo sme chceli spustiť na začiatku, aby sa dali registrovať projekty priamo cez web, čiže nemusí človek skrátka písať nejaké e-maily a tak ďalej, že budú tam formuláre pripravené preto, aby človek čo najjednoduchšie dokázal sa viac menej dostať svoj projekt jednak k
tej rade tých fotografov, ktorí vyberú, že či áno alebo nie. Takže toto je prvá vec, ktorú chceme spraviť. Druhá vec, chceme sa od budúceho roka začať zaoberať viacej aj videožurnalizmom. Mali sme tam dva také projekty a ani jeden nedostal financovanie. Jeden bol o Afganistane. Claire Billet, I think. Takže to je druhá vec. A tretia vec, že zaujíma nás tuto vo východnej Európe financovanie vlastne vizuálneho žurnalizmu. Takže s tou AONS pripravujeme na budúci rok pre taký, by som povedal, pilotný projekt pre Vyšehradskú štvorku, kde by sme chceli skúsiť niečo na spôsob toho crowdfundinga, akurát, že vzhľadom na tú ekonomicko-finančnú situáciu tohoto trhu rátame, že tie projekty budú samozrejme v menších budžetoch, ako sú tieto medzinárodné projekty, a to by bola taká budúcnosť na budúci rok.
What are your future plans? What are your future plans?
Well, my future plans is to keep working on North Korea, like I was saying, and this borders project. For now, this thing about being inside the communist countries is finished, so I'm going to be working on getting my book out and exhibitions and things like that also mm-hmm. next year. And then I have other ideas, but I don't share them until they're more ready.
During our talk over lunch, you've mentioned that what you noticed is the decline of some traditional photojournalism, but also in sense of the humanism in the photojournalism, perhaps in art as well. What did you mean by that, and how do you see it?
I noticed in a lot of magazines and a lot of art, basically, the humanistic way of looking in the world really seems to be diminishing. What do I mean by that? Like, if you go into a museum these days, it seems many times they would rather show an exhibition of different design chairs than something that links to the human condition. And the same thing is happening in magazines, rather than showing people in different situations around the world. We'll have very stylized photojournalism that's influenced by fashion or commercial concerns and things like that. And I find that to be I find it to be troubling, that the diminishing of humanism. I think it's an important thing to keep going, and I understand why people are tired about certain repetitive ways of seeing the world. So we have to innovate, we have to show new ways, we have to break apart stereotypes, but we have to keep focusing on the human condition and what it means to people across borders, across cultures, to fellow man.
So how do you like photography by Martin Parr?
That was my initial thing, is when I saw Martin Parr, it seems like he is mocking the human condition rather than having any respect for the human spirit. But that's a tradition in the United Kingdom, and so I respect that tradition, but I would hope that that's not the only view. If the only view we have of the world is just cynical mocking of other human beings, like, that'll be a very sad place, basically.
But perhaps it's also an important view. Would you not agree?
Yeah, I think it's an important compliment, and I think there are things in our own society and in middle-class British society that we can all make fun of. But I wouldn't want to see this sort of erase the other things that have to be brought up. When you're talking about totalitarianism and how people live in North Korea, it's beyond a cynical joke of poking fun at the middle class. You know, there's something important that still has to be said there that's not said in cynical mocking photography.
Ja by som sa chcel opýtať, ako ostatní členovia sedmičky fungujú, či tiež na podobnom modeli ako on, že si zháňujú vlastne takto projekty, alebo nejaké iné modely majú? To je celé.
So you're asking about the other photographers of Seven and what they do for other projects?
Yeah.
How they function. We all function a bit differently. We're all freelance, so nobody has a salary from the Seven photo agency. Some people have had contracts with magazines where the magazine guarantees them a certain number of days per year, but most of those have been cut in the last few years with the economic crisis. Some people get grants. Some other photographers have used crowdfunding in the last year only. This is a new phenomenon. A few of them do commercial work on the side also. So there's a big variety. But what brings the Seven agency together is that we're all concerned with editorial photography. So for most of us, most of our interaction with photography is photojournalism that's published either online in newspapers or magazines. There's nobody that only does commercial work and doesn't do photojournalism. We do, all of us do photojournalism, but sometimes we do other things on the side, you know, to make our living too.
So what is it that attracts you to these post-communist countries? We all have our recollections of actually living in a few years, some of us longer in a communist regime. Perhaps it was a little different regime than the one that you are actually visiting. But what is your attraction to that? And are you planning to continue in actually focusing on a political climate in looking into different aspects of political life?
I guess the first attraction was just being an outsider. I didn't grow up in a communist country. And I felt like the information that I was getting about communist countries was just very filtered and very sparse. You know, you can sit in a philosophy class and read about Marx, but I don't think that tells you much about what life is actually like in a communist country. Or during the Cold War, you could look at reporting that was coming out, but the access was very bad to communist countries, and it was also colored by the fact that there's a conflict and one side wants to win over the other. So. Communism ruled over at least a third of the earth during the 20th century, and yet I felt like I didn't have a very good understanding of it. And when I went to Nepal and saw this communist revolution happening, I said, wow, you know, it still exists, it's not dead, there's still people living under the system, what's it like? And from this curiosity, I dived in. And the thing is about communism in the 21st century is, you can't really generalize because each of these seven countries is so different. Some of them have a capitalist market economy. Some of them have a multi-party system. Some are completely totalitarian like North Korea. Others are at the start of the revolution like Nepal. So this variety of different experiences and then also trying to find a few common points between it was my attempt to discover and explore the world that I live in and the passport for me, the tool for me is my camera to go to these places.
Môžem sa opýtať, akým spôsobom vyberáte fotografie, ktoré sú dobré? Či to vyberáte vy ako fotografi sami, alebo konzultujete to medzi sebou, alebo s nejakými teoretikmi, alebo ako?
I usually do the first selection myself, but I show it to other colleagues too, most often fellow photographers. And I think a collective view on editing is very helpful because when you're actually there, you have your own emotions that are tied to the photos that an average viewer won't have. So it's good to get a second viewpoint from a photo editor or from a photographer, a friend or colleague. For the selection you've seen here, this has taken me years of looking at it again and again. I've made book dummies, tried different photos together, thrown them out, tried different ones over and over again. So I spend hours and hours and hours editing to try to get to the best picture.
And you've mentioned, of course, the different experience you have with the crowdfunding when you actually invite the backers to join in the process.
Yeah, that was helpful too. It was basically using online for what I would normally have to do in person. You know, I have a photographer friend. We might spend an evening looking at pictures, and he'll help me. In this sense, I was able to connect with people over the internet, and the backers came up with pretty good choices. And also it helped me decide which gifts that I should give them. For example, one of the things was a photographic postcard. Well, I gave the postcard that I ended up printing and giving to everyone was the one photo that got the most stars that everybody loved. So I knew they would like it. That was helpful too. And it also helped me in getting rid of some of the bad pictures and getting only the best ones into the book.
Ešte Tomasa spýtať o tej o tom čokoládovom príbehu v Severnej Koreji. Ako odôvodnil, že tam fotil, keď v podstate tam išiel ako keby na biznis a respektíve, či mu na to prišli nakoniec?
I mean, you're always watched in North Korea, but you are allowed to bring a camera with you, and you can bring it with you almost everywhere. There's just a few sites, like inside the mausoleum, where you can't bring it. But I couldn't take pictures like a photographer. I had to stay in character and just take very, very few pictures, which was a torturous experience. You know, normally as a photographer, you want to get on your knees and take dozens of pictures, and I would see things around me that I really wanted to photograph, and I just had to hold it in. Then once in a while I said, okay, there's my moment, and get it. And that was it. So it was this horrible game of discipline to try to, you know, act not like a photographer for a few weeks, basically.
Were they trying to stop you even from photographing some things, or did they actually,
On the first trip, they pulled me aside and they asked to look through my pictures because I was taking more pictures than other people in the group, and they asked to delete certain pictures, but I had a backup of everything, so luckily I didn't lose anything. And then on other occasions when we'd be in a certain place, they would kind of play games to run interference, like when I was in the metro station. It's a really very visual place to photograph. There's a lot of interesting things to shoot there, and the guide was constantly asking me for cloth to clean his camera, or standing in front of me, or just doing all kinds of things to like bother me, to keep me from taking pictures. So they're very clever, and this is a constant game for them. They constantly have people going in there who are posing as journalists or spies or journalists who are posing as tourists and other things. They know the game, and they try as hard as they can to get their propaganda message out. It's like the daily life of a Korean guide, I guess.
I would like to ask Thomas, what would be your advice to young photojournalists? General question.
I mean, the thing is, you have to, you know, figure out what you want to say in the world, and then go out and say it, and don't let anything stop you, because the media often is not going to be out there to hold your hand and help you. You have to come up with these ideas. You have to find the passion inside you. You have to go out and photograph them. And you have to find innovative ways to tell the story and innovative ways to distribute the story. And with things like Emphasis, there's now innovative ways to fund the story. I mean, why be in photography if you're not passionate about it, if you don't have something interesting and deep to say about the world? Because it's a very hard job, and you're going to meet constant obstacles, and unless you have the initiative inside yourself and you seize it and let it out, you're not going to get past all these obstacles.
Neviem, či to funguje. Chcela by som sa opýtať pána Huse, či sa celá táto embasistika iba fotografie a videožurnalizmu, alebo či víta aj iné projekty?
Tak ako som spomenul tú predchádzajúcu otázku o tej budúcnosti, tak vlastne ten vizuálny žurnalizmus tej hlavnej stránky Emphasis je gro a myslím, že to gro nebudeme prekračovať. Ale čo sa týka túto tej budúcnosti na tej východnej Európe, tak ja si myslím, že je tu priestor pre to skúsiť teda alternatívne financovať žurnalizmus ako taký, ale začať s tým vizuálnym a potom uvidíme, aký bude záujem o to, tak potenciálne prejsť. Áno, rozmýšľali sme nad tým aj ja. Aha, jasné. Chápem. jasné, takže určite hej, ale už celkovo ten vývoj takéhoto typu technológií je nákladná záležitosť a keďže sa nepohybujeme, alebo nechceme pohybovať na štýle investorov a startupov, kde skrátka treba behať niekde na východné, na západné pobrežie do Ameriky a zhaniať tam kopec peňazí na to, že všetko vlastne riešime z vlastných financií, teda väčšinu vecí máme financované z vlastných financií, takže by som ten, určite keby sme boli v štátoch, tak tá možnosť tam podľa mňa existuje teraz. Ale túto tá možnosť, ja by som videl, že najbližšie 2 roky určite nebude.
Vy v podstate mienite udržať vlastne túto internetovú bázu, pomáhať.
Áno.
A už uplatňovanie práce okrem toho ďalej vás...
Nie,
to je už záležitosť autorov.
Ani nie, lebo aj ten projekt, teda vlastne, nemyslím teraz tie jednotlivé projekty, ktoré bežia pod tým hlavným projektom.
Sú to krásne projekty, ja som uveričená.
Musia byť nejakým spôsobom smerované.
Humanným pohľadom nášho autora.
Ja sa rozumiem, ale ja ťažko povedať, lebo už keď sme robili tento prvý projekt, tak by sme vlastne boli nie prvý crowdfundingový portál na svete, ale boli sme prvý crowdfundingový portál na svete, ktorý sa venoval vizuálnemu žurnalizmu.
Áno.
Takže všetko, čo sme spravili, mali sme nejaké očakávania, mali sme nejaké potreby, ktoré sme museli naplniť, aby to prežilo. A vlastne všetko bolo zistenie, až keď sme to spustili a videli sme, koľko to bude. Jedna z tých vecí, ako som hovoril, o tých návštevníkoch.
Bude sa to tvárovať priebežne. A je to krásne.
Takže je to taký, by som povedal, experiment a keď to vyjde a toto vyšlo, tak si myslím, že dá sa to posunúť zase niekam ďalej, ale musí sa to skôr upraviť na tie lokálne podmienky. Preto chceme riešiť ten Vyšegrad a nie iba Slovensko, lebo ten Vyšegrad má nejaké spojenie, sú nejaké fondy, aj európske, aj vyšegradské, takže dá sa s tým nejakým spôsobom pracovať a chceli by sme to skúsiť namapovať na
podobnú
na
problematiku. Level. Vidíme.
Odpovedá to? Hej?
Odpovedá to. Ďakujem vám.
Toto presne aj mňa zaujalo, akým spôsobom sa vlastne prispôsobíte lokálnym podmienkam, keď chcete robiť fotožurnalizmus a vizuálnu žurnalistiku, lebo teda, ako aj povedal Tomáš, tak tam vlastne tie pôvodné zdroje, ktoré sa nazbierajú, sú použité hlavne na pokrytie produkcie. Tým pádom ako keby nepokrývajú prácu, alebo iba ak je to overfunded, tak až vtedy vlastne fotograf alebo videožurnalista získava nejakú cenu a neviem, on samozrejme z toho, ako to opisoval Tomáš, ako som to pochopila, si to môže potom zarobiť z toho, že to predá do médií, ktorí o to majú záujem, neviem, či na Slovensku alebo vôbec v krajinách Vyšegradskej štvorky je reálne uvažovať v týchto finančných intenciách, že či vlastne fotožurnalista, ktorý by sa venoval nejakej téme, má šancu potom to predať. Neviem teraz, či v rámci regiónu alebo skôr je dobre sa zameriavať možno na svetové médiá, predáva to tam.
No a ešte plus náklady okrem toho, ktoré má ten fotožurnalizmus, plus má náklady ten projekt ako samotný, hej, čiže je tam nejaká prevádzka, plus nejakí ďalší ľudia sa tomu venujú, takže tých nákladov je tam ďaleko viacej. A ja som skôr myslel, že venovať sa akože Vyšegradu, ako regionálne, ale publikovať to smerom von. Hej, čiže nepublikovať to tu tak na tie lokálne médiá, ale skôr dostávať, lebo teraz napríklad tá európska diverzita je, a sme všetci v Európskej únii viacej menej, v celom Vyšegrade, hej, aj keď niektorí sú neni v eurozóne, alebo neviem čo, ale skrátka sme v EU a bude podľa mňa zaujímavé pre západnú Európu vedieť o východnej Európe veci, čo sa týka aj kultúry, aj sociálnych vecí, takže určite ten priestor tu je. A jednu z takých dvoch vecí, určite by sme chceli skúsiť to crowdfundingové financovanie, že či naozaj ľudia sú ochotní dať a koľko a ako, hej. Viem, že ten Emphasis model sa tu nedá dať, lebo určite nevyzbierame, neviem, 16 000 eur na nejaký projekt, to o tom silne pochybujem, tak preto som hovoril, že tie sumy budú asi nižšie, ešte presne to nemáme premyslené ako, ale budú určite nižšie, tie projekty budú menšie, ale jedna vec je, že chceme skúsiť to financovanie od tých ľudí, tých crowdom, a druhá vec je, že by sme cez tie granty skúšali dofinancovať nejaké tie projekty, také tie zaujímavejšie. Takže chceli by sme vytvoriť aj, by som povedal, taký nejaký fond, ktorý by pre tie projekty, ktoré dosiahnu napríklad 75% financovanie, tak to budeme vedieť, my potom dotlačiť ešte nejakým ďalej, aby tie projekty skrátka nezmizli. Ale keby mal ten projekt iba, neviem, 25% financovanie, tak tým pádom by sme vedeli, že ľudia nemajú o to záujem, tak nebudeme to dofinancovať. Takže to sú také tie modely, ktoré ako rozmýšľame nad tým, že akým spôsobom by sa to dalo riešiť. toto mi príde reálne.
Ja by som sa ešte Tomasa chcel spýtať. Vzniklo pár fotosérií z Líbie, ktoré boli fotené iPhoneom. A že čo má aký na to názor, že keď bol aj v Severnej Koreji, že či by mu to častokrát nejak neuľahčilo tú pretvárku? Alebo aký má na to vôbec názor, akoby, že stať sa nejakým amatérským fotografom v chvíli, kedy je to treba?
Unfortunately, in North Korea, when you arrive, the first thing they do is take away your mobile phone. So this is the one country where the iPhone wouldn't work. but almost anywhere else. I don't know of any other country that takes away your phone. I think it's a real advantage. Actually, I like the smaller and more discreet a camera is, as long as it's fast, I like it. I think the iPhone is a step in the right direction for photographers that are working in those kind of conditions where they need to be as discreet as possible. I have mixed feelings about Hipstamatic, which adds a lot of filters to it. So actually on my iPhone, I use Hipstamatic, but I use the lens that doesn't do any distortion, and I try to find the film that doesn't change the colors at all. But as far as the tool, having a very small thing that can take pictures quickly, I think this is a great innovation for journalism.
It's Why do you not like Hipstamatic? I mean, okay, you said you use it, but I mean, why do you not like the filters?
I don't like the filters. You know, the I mean, I have friends that use all of the filters and have no problem with it. But I guess I'm a little bit of a purist when it comes to photojournalism, that I feel like as much as you can find in the content that makes a strong photo, the better. So it's kind of, I take this view of you should do everything upstream. You know, it's upstream that you decide the decisions of what should be in the photo and not adding all kinds of things at the bottom. I like to make the analogy with food. If you want really good food, then you start with the freshest vegetables and the best quality things, and you don't add a bunch of sugary sauce at the end. For me, Hipstamatic is like adding a bunch of sugary sauce at the end. You can have a crappy photo, put a lot of sauce on it, and it looks kind of cool. I would rather have a photo that's just like has the perfect elemental fundamentals, and who cares about the sauce afterwards?
Thank you. This is great.
Thank you.
Tak, ak nie sú ďalšie otázky, alebo ešte sú? Ak nie sú, poďakujem vám všetkým, že ste si našli čas. A ešte je.
Chcel by som sa Tomasa spýtať, že aké je to fungovať v takom zoskupení, ako je sedmička, kde sú svetové fotografii, že či je ovplyvnený týmito fotografmi a že čo si myslí o odchode Jamesa Nachtveja, ktorý je jednotkou vlastne v tomto svete, tak fotografie.
It's definitely nice to be in a group of like-minded individuals, and it gives me a lot of inspiration. I mean, it's imagine if you're an athlete and one day you join a good team or an Olympic team or something like that, all of a sudden all those other ones around you are going to inspire you to be better. So there's some competitiveness and inspiration that comes from it. I just joined as a full member of the agency recently, and so I didn't have any interaction with James Nachtveja. Probably like you, I've, you know, as a student, looked at his books and looked up to him and things like that, but I didn't have any personal interaction with him. I mean, I think the photos that he contributed to Seven during the first 10 years since it was founded helped establish it as an agency. But now the agency is quite strong and well known, so it's not 100% essential that he stays with us. He can, you know, he can move on with his career, but personally I don't have any good insight on it.
Nech sa páči, nechcem nikoho obrať o príležitosť. Ak je to tak všetko, tak mi dovolte poďakovať sa našim dnešným hosťom Tomasovi Van Hatriffovi a Janovi Husárovi a taktiež vám, že ste si v tomto predvianočnom čase našli čas a prišli ste podebatovať o súčasných dilemách fotožurnalistiky, nových spôsoboch financovania kvalitných fotografií a všetko dobré do príjemné sviatky teda. Do nového roku ešte nie.